Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for tuning in. For those watching for the first time, welcome. My name is Dan Pardo, and this is the 18th episode of Pardo's Turn, my weekly Wednesday web series where I analyze a classic show tune from a music director's point of view, and with the help of a special guest, perhaps shed some light on what makes the gems of our musical theater canon so great. On today's show, I am so happy to have on the beautiful and talented Elizabeth Stanley, best known for originating the roles of Diane in Million Dollar Quartet, Allison in Crybaby, April in John Doyle's revival of Company, and most recently, Claire de Lune in On the Town. On the road, she starred in the national tours of both Xanadu and the Bridges of Madison County. She just finished up a run of the Broadway-bound Jagged Little Pill at ART, directed by Diane Paulus, and wowed audiences last summer as Mother in Ragtime at the Barrington Stage, where she serves as an associate artist. Today, we're examining I Wish It So from the famous flop Juno, written by Marc Blitzstein, best known for his political opus The Cradle Will Rock. Despite being written in 1959, the middle of Broadway's golden age, I Wish It So is much closer stylistically to early American operetta. And given Blitzstein's career as a classically trained concert pianist, who then studied composition at Curtis and in Europe with both Arnold Schoenberg and the famed teacher Nadia Boulanger, it's not too surprising. His first lyric, which begins, "I've an unrest inside me," is preceded by a series of mournful suspensions, quite direct in their musical implication, like a foreign opera where the score is so emotional you don't even need to understand the words to get the meaning. The unrest is dramatized further with the injection of measures set in 3/8 time, interrupting the gentle sway of the verse's 6/8 feel with musical hiccups. Melodically, the vocal line is anxious in its contour, never quite building a satisfying line up or down, and the harmonization, with more than a few chords built on their first or second inversions, also contributes to the general instability. But then we reach the refrain, and wow, how things change fast. I Wish It So may be the quintessential I Want song, to the extent that the title lyric says so flat out. Musically, it marches forward with all the qualities absent from the verse. A steady 4/4 meter with predictable phrase lengths, an expressive melody that reaches exuberant highs and somber lows, and an optimistic, anthemic lyric. While the harmonization of the title lyric at the top of the refrain is tinged with doubt, the melody is triumphant, stepwise, in a strong part of the soprano's voice up to the tonic. "For I wish it so." Similarly, the refrain ends with a sturdy 2/5/1 progression, again with the voice squarely on the root of the chord. "I wish it so." After an interlude which often gets cut in performance, the title lyric returns, but this time, not only is the harmony bittersweet, the melody itself collapses down a fifth. "I wish it so." And in a moment, the unrest of the verse returns for the coda. It's heartbreaking, raw, honest, and because of the quasi-operetta style, the actor can go there emotionally without apologizing, minimizing its effect with a joke, or hiding behind some metaphor. It's really powerful stuff. Thank you so much for coming on. This is such a treat, such a pleasure. Let's talk about the song choice, because that's always the thing I find most interesting right out of the gate when I'm lucky enough to have that response that says, yeah, let's do it. It's like, what song are they going to pick? Especially with someone like you who's had such a broad career. You know, I saw you in On the Town, which is, you know, on the more classical end, and you know, did Crybaby, and then we kind of met doing something more middle of the road with Stephen Schwartz, and you settled on the Blitzstein.
Yeah.
So what is it, do you have a history with that song, or?
Ish. Mm-hmm. Don Upshaw has an album of that title, and that is a song on it that I got when I was in high school that I loved. That was just like one of my first sort of music idols, someone, you know, who has an extraordinary voice, but at least on that album does some crossing over into the music theater world,
right,
which was sort of my path into it as well, starting in the classical world. So,
which school did you go to?
I went to Indiana.
Okay, so at Bloomington?
Jacob School, yeah.
What's their theater program like?
It's, well, they've always had a theater program, mm-hmm. but it's in a completely different school. Okay. So when I was there, they didn't really like enjoy each other.
Yeah.
You know, so it was
not much cross-pollination.
Right? It was like the people who sang anything besides opera were like heathens. And then the mm-hmm. same thing, like people that weren't just like classical actors, you know, that were interested in doing horrible musicals,
right.
Were sort of shunned. But you know what I loved is that, like, it made us all really, people that did like musicals, it
mm-hmm.
made us kind of band together and like create things together, rather than some of my friends who I feel like have gone to these really renowned conservatories, which are also great in their own right, but I feel like sometimes they graduate and they're really like competitive with each other.
Right.
You know, because they've had to fight so much
exactly.
already, and I didn't have to start like claiming a place.
What would your old, Indiana Jacobs professors think of you singing along this Morissette on stage? You just finished a about an ART. What was that like?
It was a really special experience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you just never know what a piece is going to become, no matter how much you put into it.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are just so many factors. And I think sometimes, especially jukebox musicals, it's a little even more precarious about like, well, can we pull it off,
mm-hmm.
you know? Because there's so many people have different ideas of what they want from it because they already have a relationship with the music.
Right.
So.
Was the fan base and the audiences mostly the kind of typical theater crowd, or were there a lot of, you know, people who grew up with the album as an album?
I was so fascinated to like be like, who are these people that are
mm-hmm.
going to see the show? It was a really a mixed bag.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of the season ticket holders
right.
at ART, which is, I would say, people like my parents' demographic.
Mm-hmm.
But then there were a lot of people like my age, like, and I would say really like Alanis fans are probably people that are like between, I don't know, 35 and 55,
yeah.
probably. Like,
I remember my sister, who's 3 years older than I am, and I'm 31, got the album in high school, and
yeah.
You know, she was obsessed with it, and therefore I was obsessed with it.
Right.
And you know, I was actually really surprised when I started reading about the show that it wasn't set in the 90s, because so much of, you know, my experience of it was through that lens of 90s teen angst.
Totally.
And I think a lot of the comparisons, you know, in terms of the genre, came from American Idiot, and that was produced so quickly after the album came out. They kind of, you know, were able to fit it in more in a more contemporary time period, rather than trying to rediscover the album, you know, 20 years later.
Right. Yeah.
But that must have been a fun discussion too.
It's been actually kind of awesome
mm-hmm.
because at least, I mean, I suppose if the people hated it, they're not going to talk to me after the show. So they're probably those people to exist. But,
mm-hmm.
You know, the people that I spoke to were really inspired by how relevant the songs still were
mm-hmm.
and, like, the new ways in which they were being interpreted. And then there was a whole other large portion of the audience, which were teenagers,
mm-hmm.
Who had really never heard the music before, most of them, but loved it.
Yeah.
Even, like, Diane Paulus even said, like, she's like, you know, I've been trying to get my daughter to listen to it. I've been playing it around the house the past, like, 2 years. And
mm-hmm.
she's like, ugh. And then she came and saw the show, and now she's, like, obsessed, and now
right.
I love music.
It was funny. I happen to be a fan of the show This Is Us, which I know is very polarizing. But, okay, then you must have appreciated that episode where the
yes.
daughter goes to the Alanis Morissette concert.
Yes.
And it seemed, I'm like, oh, I'm so old, because this is, like, the big flashback.
Right.
And she's, but
wait
same,
a minute. Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like, oh yeah, I guess that wasn't that long ago. Veering back to I Wish It So a little bit,
yeah.
So much of our musical thumbprint and our musical identity is kind of formed during these, you know, high school and middle school years, as it appears it was for you listening to this album. So have you seen her in concert since moving to the city? Have you worked with her?
I did see her in concert forever ago, though.
Mm-hmm.
It was like when I first moved here. It was her and Audra McDonald, and I feel like it was an evening of music by Ricky Ian Gordon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I've never seen her live since then. I feel like I used to listen to people's solo albums a lot more when I was studying and learning about the business. And
mm-hmm.
And now it's rare that I will like really be into someone's album.
Yeah, well, I feel like the whole idea of, you know, going to a Borders or going to a Barnes & Noble and seeing who has the album, that was an experience, you know, seeing what cast albums came out that year, who has a solo album, you know, bring it into your iTunes library. It's just such a different experience of consuming music now.
Totally is. Well, I feel like I didn't really answer your initial question fully. In that I wish it so I chose it because of Don Upshaw, but I actually, like, I never sang it when I got that album. It wasn't like a song I had in my rep, and it wasn't until I did my first solo show, I don't know, a while ago now, I think maybe 6 years ago, that I pulled it out again, and then I was like, oh, these lyrics are so powerful to me.
Yeah, they're so simple and straightforward and direct.
Yeah.
You know, that's not to say that there's no poetry in them, but, you know, you can just, something about these early kind of quasi-operetta pieces are just so straight to the point and straight to the heart.
Yeah. Yeah, and I love everything about it. I love the way that it's written. Like, the thoughts are coming to you. You know, I feel like that's written into the music, which is really cool, I think. And yeah, every time I sing it, I'm like,
politics of Broadway for it to come in?
I've been teaching voice lessons.
That's great.
This year, which has been really awesome, actually. Like, you
is
know,
your roster full, or can people contact
you? I've got room.
Okay.
I've got room. Call me. Okay. And I'm doing a symphony gig in St. Louis next weekend, so I have, you know, some things like that in there. The concept of the concert is celebrating the 100th anniversary of the Muni.
Oh, okay,
so
sure.
It's all like shows that have been done there throughout the ages. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them that they chose are ones that were done quite some time ago. Mm-hmm.
Have you performed at the Muni before?
I grew up 3 hours from there, which is that's mm-hmm. the closest like major theater from, you know, well, that and the Fox, but mm-hmm. St. Louis is the closest big city, so yeah, I wanted to go out and hire a couple times and then haven't, it hasn't been able to come to fruition. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so
they only want you for like 2 weeks.
I know, it's like really insane.
But she's so in demand. I don't know how I got her on this
program.
It's
not like that.
If you love this episode as much as I love doing it, please click that subscribe button, like, comment, share, follow Jagged Little Pill to Broadway, hopefully this winter, spring, maybe?
I hope so.
And we'll see you next Wednesday on Pardo's Turn. Bye!
What I wish it's all, what I wish...